Playboy's penthouse. I'm Hugh Hefner, editor-publisher of Playboy magazine. And tonight, we're talking to Dr. Michael Dean. The doctor has degrees from Minnesota, Columbia, Northwestern, a PhD in semantics, which he teaches. But the doctor is also a hypnotist, and it's hypnotism we've been talking about tonight. Right now, he's talking to some of our guests and seeing who among them is the most susceptible. And let's go on in and see how he's doing. He's apparently doing pretty well.
We have some pretty good subjects, Hugh.
Very good.
When I count to five, you'll open your eyes feeling better than you ever felt before in your life. When I count to five, open your eyes feeling wonderful. One, two, three, four, and five. Wake up feeling wonderful. Well, I've got some good subjects, but I do not want to hypnotize anyone on camera. I would suggest that everyone move back, including members of the audience at home. I don't want them to hear my voice while I hypnotize the individuals here.
Okay.
Because people will be falling asleep all over the country.
All right, fine. We don't want that. Suppose we just step over here for a minute while you do put me to a bit.
May I go with you?
There is a real danger because the sound of the doctor's voice by itself can, with people that are particularly susceptible, actually put them into a deep trance. So while he's putting the guest that he selected into a deep trance here now, we'll just kind of stay back in the background.
Okay, Hugh.
All right.
My guest.
Okay, fine. Half the room is asleep.
When I count to three, you'll see the funniest movie you have ever seen in your life, and the more you laugh, the more you'll be going deeper and deeper to sleep. One, two, and three. There it is. The funniest movie you have ever seen in your life. And the more you laugh, the more you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. The funniest movie. Louder. And the more you laugh, the more you are going deeper and deeper to sleep with each breath that you take. It is so funny. The funniest movie you have ever seen in your life. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. Louder. It is so funny. This movie is so funny. And now when I count to three, the movie will be getting so cold. Oh, it is getting so cold, so cold. Make yourself comfortable. It is so cold. The coldest room you have ever been in your life. So cold. Make yourself comfortable. Getting so cold. The coldest room you have ever been in your life. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. So cold. Make yourself comfortable. And now when I count to three, I want you to know that this room is getting so hot. One, two, three. The hottest room you have ever been in your life. Getting so warm. In fact, it is so warm, you want a glass of water. Who wants a glass of water? Raise your hand if you want a glass of water. The hottest room you have ever been in your life. Who wants a glass of water? Here's a glass of water for you. Drink it down all the way. Here's a glass of water for you. Drink it down all the way. Here's a glass of water for you. Drink it down all the way. Here's a glass of water for you. Drink it down all the way. Here's a glass of water for you. Drink it down all the way. All the way. When you've had enough, throw the glass away. It tastes wonderful. Oh, that's it. The most wonderful tasting water you've ever had in your life. And now this movie's starting to get funny once more. There it is. The funniest movie you have ever seen in your life. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. The funniest movie you have ever seen in your life. And now when I count to three, the movie will get so sad. One, two, three. So sad. Rub your eyes. So sad. The saddest movie. Rub your eyes. So sad. Starting to cry louder. The saddest movie you have ever seen in your life. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. So sad. The saddest movie. And now this movie is getting so hot. Once more, you cannot keep your shoes on. Kick off your shoes. Make yourself comfortable. The hottest room you have ever been in your life. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. This room getting so hot. So hot. Kick off your shoes. You cannot keep those shoes on. The more you try, the more you cannot. That's it. Kick off your shoes. Take off your socks. You cannot keep them on. Take off your socks, and you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. You cannot keep your shoes on. You cannot keep your socks on. The more you try, the more you cannot. And you are going deeper to sleep. Way down. Deeper and deeper to sleep. Way down. Deeper and deeper to sleep. This room is so warm. The hottest room you have ever been in your life. When I count to five, you'll all open your eyes feeling wonderful. So amazed and so surprised that you do not have your shoes on. But the moment you try to get those shoes, you cannot. The moment you try to get those shoes, you cannot, because you are stuck tight to that chair. When I count to five, all of you open your eyes feeling wonderful. Except you, whose forehead I'm touching, you have developed the most terrific stutter you have ever had in your life. You will stutter and stammer on every word, every letter. When I count to five, all of you open your eyes feeling wonderful, glued stuck tight to that chair. One, two, three, four, and five. Open your eyes feeling wonderful. How do you feel, sir?
Fine.
What is your name?
Joe.
Joe what?
Curtis.
Joe Curtis. What are you doing with your shoes on, Joe? Your name?
Merle.
Merle?
Fertel.
Fertel. And your name, young lady?
Gloria.
Gloria. And your name?
Sharon.
Sharon, what are you doing with your shoes off? You don't have your shoes off, do you? What is your name?
Let's put our shoes on, kids.
Joe, would you put your shoes on?
Ellen.
I wish I could.
Joe, will you be a gentleman and help the young ladies with their shoes?
I can't even help myself.
Look at that, Sandra.
Oh,
would you help them get their shoes? Very. There you are. Now, what is your name again? Huh? What is your name again? What is your name? Let's see if Joe can get his shoes on. Joe, how are you doing?
They might as well be back out there.
You're not trying very hard, Joe. Sandra, would you help Joe put his shoes on? The more you try, the more you cannot. Those shoes will go to the left of his feet, to the right of his feet. You cannot find his feet. The more you try, the more you cannot. You cannot put them on. The more you try, the more you cannot. And you are going deeper and deeper to sleep. Physically impossible to put those shoes on. The more you try, the more you cannot. You cannot find your feet. That is so silly. The funniest thing. In fact, when I count to three, Gloria, you will try to put your shoes on. You can get out of your chair. You can get your shoes. But you cannot put them on your feet. The more you try, the more you cannot. One, two, three. You can get out. What did you say? I thought you were going to help him. Weren't you going to help him put a shoe on? No? All right. All right, you can talk. You do not stutter anymore. What is your name?
Sandra.
Sandra? You don't stutter, do you?
No, sir.
Joe, do you stutter?
No.
Now you do. What is your name? Your name, sir?
Joe.
Joe what?
Curtis.
Do you stutter, Joe?
No.
Joe, now you don't stutter anymore. What is your name, sir?
Joe Curtis.
Do you stutter, Joe?
No.
Now you do. What is your name? Isn't he funny, Sandra?
Yes.
You don't stutter, do you?
No, sir.
What was your name again?
Sandra.
Now you stutter. What is your name? The most terrific stutter. What is your name? Look at Joe. She stutters. Isn't that silly?
Huh? No!
Didn't she say? Do you stutter, Joe? Do you stutter? Now, you don't stutter anymore, none of you. Do you believe in hypnosis, young lady? Do you believe in hypnosis?
No!
You don't? Have you ever been hypnotized before?
No, sir.
You haven't? You don't believe in hypnosis? I'm Michael Bean. Happy to meet you, Sandra. Very happy to meet you. He doesn't trust me. Do you trust me? Have you ever been hypnotized before?
Well, I guess you hypnotized me.
You believe in hypnosis?
Yeah.
Huh?
I don't know.
Have you ever been hypnotized before I hypnotized you?
Oh, no.
What is your name?
Sharon.
Sharon, I'm Michael Bean. Happy to meet you. Sweet. Look at that.
I want to put my shoes on.
You want to put your shoes on?
My feet are cold.
What is your name?
Gloria.
Gloria Slate. And your name was?
Merle.
Merle, how do you feel? You feel pretty good? Have you ever been hypnotized before?
Yes.
You have been. You are a good subject, aren't you? Slate. Joe, how are you? It's good to see you. It's way down. Sit up in your chair, both of you. Sit up, Joe, and go deeper to sleep than you were before. Sit up and go deeper to sleep. That's it. Sandra, would you shake my hand now? Sandra, I can't put you to sleep unless you shake my hand. Huh? Sandra, sleep. Way. As you can see, Hugh, they are very fine subjects.
I can see. And we'll be back in just one moment.
Go deep sleep. Relax your body entirely. When I count to five, you'll all open your eyes feeling better than you ever felt before in your life. When I count to five, open your eyes feeling wonderful, but you will have the most tremendous urge to have a cigarette. The moment you hear me say the word psychology, you put that cigarette in your right hand, and out of your right hand, that cigarette will taste wonderful. The moment you hear me say the word psychology, you will put that cigarette in your right hand. And out of your right hand, that cigarette will taste wonderful. The instant you hear me say the word hypnotism, you will immediately put the cigarette in your left hand. And out of your left hand, that cigarette will taste so vile, so bad, so evil tasting. When I count to five, open your eyes, feeling wonderful. The moment you hear me say the word hypnotism, you will put that cigarette in your left hand, and it will be the worst tasting cigarette you have ever had in your life. You'll not get sick, but it will taste so bad. When I count to five, open your eyes, feeling wonderful, with the most tremendous urge for a cigarette. One, two, three, four, and five. Open your eyes, feeling wonderful. What's that, sir? What is that? They what? Sure they do. Look. Is that better?
That's better.
When I count to five, open your eyes, feeling wonderful. One, two, three, four, and five. Open your eyes, feeling wonderful.
You got a cigarette?
What is that, sir?
Cigarette, please.
I guess, is it okay to smoke here?
Of course.
There you are. You don't want a cigarette, do you? Do you want a cigarette?
Yes, yeah,
oh.
Not that kind of.
Oh, not that. What kind would you like?
A lucky strike.
Anyone have a lucky strike?
Right over there.
I have.
Have a cigarette. Is it good? How does your cigarette taste? Hmm? Pretty good. Yours? And yours? All right. And yours? Tastes good? Now, basically, in order to enjoy a cigarette, you must understand the psychology of smoking. More specifically, however, this is a scientific demonstration in hypnotism. Now, in hypnotism, the subconscious mind takes over for the conscious mind, and you will get a different kind of a reaction entirely. How's your cigarette, Gloria? You'll not get sick. Joe, how's your cigarette?
Tastes like old leaves. Or even worse.
Or even worse? You will not get sick. Cigarette tastes so bad, so vile. Sandra, why don't you take a puff? This is an interesting subject. Why don't you take a puff? Huh? Yes, you.
She fights,
Yeah, she fights suggestions. Oh, yes. Many times individuals do. You should not actually force them. Mm-hmm. You should never do that. How's your cigarette?
It tastes like I love.
Didn't you just say the cigarette tastes pretty good?
Yeah, but...
Huh? What's the matter, Joe? You'll not get sick. You don't want that cigarette? You don't want yours? All right, you may put them out then if you like. Joe, you don't want your cigarette?
It's on themselves.
You don't want yours? You want to put yours out there?
I thought you gave me a lucky strike.
Isn't that a lucky strike?
That's what it says, but it don't taste like it.
Doesn't taste like it. Well, you better put it out then. You sure you don't want a cigarette, Joe?
No, I'll pass.
Basically, this means that they do not understand the psychology of smoking, because if you understand the psychology of smoking, of course, the cigarette will taste wonderful. Psychology is the study of the human mind and human behavior.
When you said psychology, Merle was completely unaware of the fact that she switched from one hand to another.
Uh-huh. Yes? This happens on the unconscious level. Anything we can do to make you feel better now, Joe? Huh? None at all. Look at his lips. You want a cigarette?
Don't you want it? I'll take it.
There you are. You want a cigarette? Take a puff, Joe. It tastes wonderful. Is that better?
That's more like it.
You cannot find your mouth. That cigarette will go to the left of your mouth, to the right of your mouth. The more you try to smoke it, the more you cannot. Physically impossible to find your mouth. The more you try, the more you cannot. So embarrassing. Most embarrassing thing you've ever seen in your life. Look at that, girls. He cannot find his mouth. The funniest thing you've ever seen in your life. And Sandra, the more you try to help him, the more you cannot. You cannot find his mouth either. The more you try, the more you cannot. You cannot find his mouth. The more you try, the more you cannot.
You're not much help.
Physically impossible to find, isn't it? The more you try, the more you... Wait, let me show you how simple it is, okay? When I count to three, you can find your mouth. One, two, three. There you are. But the moment you smoke, stuck tight in your mouth, you cannot take it out. Stuck tight, you cannot take it out. The more you try, the more you cannot. Now, it's starting to puff like a steam engine. Whoa! You will not get sick, but you cannot take it out. The more you try, the more you cannot. When I count to three, you can take out the cigarette. One, two, and three. There you are. Would you like to give up smoking, sir?
No, but I think I'll go back to a pipe.
But you did want to stop smoking, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I will stop you, of course, after the show. Okay, do you feel okay? You all feel okay? Sandra, do you feel okay? Huh? Sweet. When they are under hypnosis, they fall in an extremely relaxed feeling. No danger unless they should hit their heads or hit on some sharp object. All right, would you put your cigarettes out, please? Notice I put her to sleep. He fell under, too, because he is a good subject. This gentleman, by the way, is quite intrigued because he did not believe in it until tonight, right?
I'm still sweating.
Sleep, sleep, wake up. Deep asleep. You are all in a wonderful deep sleep. When I count to five, you'll open your eyes feeling better than you ever felt before in your life. Joe, I want you to know. Hugh, do you have about $100 that I could give Joe if he can pick it up? About 10 tens. When I count to five, you'll open your eyes feeling better than you ever felt before in your life. And you girls will want to help Joe pick up this $100, 10 tens. But Sandra, you, all of you, in fact, are stuck tight to that chair. You cannot get up. The more you try, the more you cannot. When I count to five, open your eyes feeling better than you ever have felt before in your life.
A couple of hundred.
I will put $200?
Well, more or less.
And Joe, you're going to be quite exasperated because this is a lot of money. You can use this money. Yes, you can. When I count to five, open your eyes feeling wonderful. If you can pick up the money, it is yours. But it is stuck.
Oh, yeah.
It is stuck tied to the floor. You cannot pick it up. The more you try, the more you cannot, and you'll be so exasperated. When I count to five, all of you open your eyes, feeling wonderful, stuck tight to that chair. One, two, three, four, and five. Open your eyes, feeling wonderful. Joe, can you use about 100 or 200? What? Wait. What are you doing? What are you doing? Sleep. I count to five, open your eyes, feeling wonderful. One, two, three, four, and five, open your eyes, feeling wonderful.
You're sure it's safe, right?
Joe, would you like to have a couple $100?
It always helps.
You can have it if you can pick it up. Here.
I'll pick it up.
Who will?
I will.
You will? Here.
I can't even get up myself.
Joe, you can get up off your chair. Only you. $20. Stuck tight to the floor. You cannot pick it up. The more you try, the more you cannot. It is so heavy, you cannot pick it up. The more you try, the more you cannot. Joe, how much you weigh, Joe?
240.
240. How tall are you, sir?
I don't think I'm tall enough, right?
240 pounds. $20. Here are 10 more. You can pan down to show that they are legitimate currency. $30. You cannot pick them up. The more you try, the more you cannot. $40. Stuck tight. You cannot pick them up. 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, $100. You cannot pick them up. You cannot pick them up. The more you try, the more you cannot. And you are going deeper and deeper in sleep. You want Sandra to help you? Sandra, you can get up, but you cannot pick them up. The more you try, the more you cannot. You can get off your chair, but you cannot pick them up, and you're going to be so exasperated. Stuck tight, the more you try, the more you cannot, and you are going deeper and deeper to sleep, stuck tight to that floor.
It's not worth it.
And you are going deeper.
Think how much to cure the rupture, huh? Boy. Oh, forget about it.
Please,
huh?
Once, both of you can try.
Come on, please help me.
You cannot get it up. The more you try, the more you cannot.
Take that side.
You cannot get it up. The more you try, it is stuck tight. You cannot get it up. The more you try, the more you cannot. Here, let me show you how easy it is. Let me show you how easy it is. Will you sit back, please?
I'd like to.
With two fingers. I once had a professional wrestler who could not pick it up, and his brother claimed that he could because he really liked money. Two fingers. See?
All right.
Isn't that legitimate money? Joe, it's yours if you can hold it.
If I can hold it?
Yeah, if you can hold it.
You can hold it? I don't know. If I can pick it up.
It's yours if you can hold it. Is that legitimate money?
Yeah, it looks good to me.
Huh?
Yeah.
It's yours if you can hold it.
Hold it.
When I count to three, it's too heavy. It'll fall to the floor. One, two, three. So heavy you can't. Whoa! You can't hold it. Up.
Let's try it at about 50.
50 what? $50?
Yeah, maybe.
Oh, I see. Well, 10, 20, 40, $50. Oh, that isn't too heavy. $50, that isn't too heavy.
Put it on your knee.
Put it on your knee? All right, you can even put it on your knee.
Put your hands on your knee.
Put your hands on your knee. But when you fall forward, you will not fall on your head. Gotta make sure of that. You cannot hold it. It is too heavy. You cannot hold it. It is too heavy. Do we have any more skeptics in the audience?
Never thought I'd get that back.
Dr. Dean, we've been enjoying the entertaining side of hypnotism here this evening, but this is a pretty serious matter that I guess is getting more serious all the time in terms of greater understanding of hypnotism.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is, Hugh. More and more we are understanding the medical, the dental, implications of hypnosis. It's well known, the average person knows of the uses of hypnosis, for example, in childbirth.
Mm-hmm.
In dentistry, some of the things that I did, many dentists would like to achieve this. By this I mean having the jaws completely open. There is in dentistry what we call the gagging syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Under hypnosis, the dental patient would not gag. There would be no pain, no fear, no bleeding, because you can literally stop the flow of blood with hypnosis and no post-operative effects.
Now, you did this thing here tonight with the smoking and making the cigarettes taste badly. I understand it's actually possible to, if a person wants to, give up something like smoking, or if I want to give up the pipe, you could actually, through hypnotism, break the habit.
That is right. With hypnosis, you can stop them from smoking, biting fingernails, weight reduction diets. In fact, wherever I appear around the country, I give free therapy.
Mm-hmm.
Because in my opinion, there are only two justifications for a professional hypnotist. Number one, in educating people that hypnosis is true, that it is a fact. Because you have to see hypnosis in order to believe it. You saw the amazing things and the tremendous relaxation.
Mm-hmm.
And number two, if people are nice enough to come and volunteer as a subject, or even if they don't, I will give them free therapy. This is the only justification of a hypnotist.
Well, what's most interesting about hypnotism to me is that it isn't a mystical thing or a fact apart from life. In simple truth, it's related to persuasion, to advertising, to brainwashing, if you will. It's related to things we come in contact with every day in life.
Precisely. This is how I got into it, Hugh. In my own classes in teaching the psychology of persuasion, public speaking, mm-hmm. you have the beginning of hypnosis. On the other hand, I teach a science called general semantics,
mm-hmm.
which is the study of the relationship between language, thought, and human behavior, teaching people how not to be persuaded by others. This is the whole continuum of persuasion. And we have, in our advertising agencies, and especially the extreme form of persuasion, had a call.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
This is the only way to understand some of the elements of suggestion, and I wish more professors of psychology would get into the area of hypnosis, because there is so much more about the human mind and human persuasion that we do not understand.
Well, I think if we understand more about persuasion, we'll also understand more how not to be persuaded in the wrong ways.
That's right.
We're going to have to take a break for just one moment. To introduce you to Bob Newhart.
Thank you. I think, first of all, I ought to premise this with a few remarks. This routine largely evolved from some advertising people I knew and also a book written by Vance Packard called The Hidden Persuaders. Now, one of the points in the book is that the advertising people know us better than we know ourselves. They know why we buy a product. We think we buy it for another reason, but they know the real reason we buy it. And this got me to thinking, what if the science of advertising had been as far advanced during the Civil War as it is today, and there was no Lincoln, you see. Now, the advertising people, realizing what the public wanted, might have created a Lincoln. And I think the following telephone conversation might have taken place between Abe and his advertising manager just before Gettysburg. Go something like this.
Hi, Abe, sweetheart. How's everything, kid? How's Gettysburg, baby? Sort of a drag, uh-huh. Well, you know them small Pennsylvania towns, Abe. Seen one, you've seen them all. Right, listen, Abe, I got your note. What's the problem? You're thinking of what? You're thinking of shaving it off. Abe, you're kidding me, aren't you? Huh? You're pulling Neil's leg, aren't you, huh? No. Abe, don't you see it's part of the image? Right, with a shawl and the stovepipe hat. Don't you see that? You don't have the shawl. Where's the shawl, Abe? You left it in Washington. What are you wearing, Abe? A sort of cardigan? Abe, don't you see that isn't the image we want? Abe, I'm not saying that. People won't identify. I'm not saying that, Abe. Abe, they voted for you. See, Abe, the image and you, it's all kind of tied up together. Another thing, what else? It itches. Abe, let me put it to you this way. Would you rather be a president with an itchy beard or an attorney in Illinois? It's that simple. Right, I'm not knocking Illinois, Abe. Abe, leave the beard on. Would you do that? Abe, you're a sweetheart. All right, what's this about Grant now? You're getting a lot of complaints about Grant's drinking. I don't see the problem, to tell you the truth, Abe. Well, I mean, you knew he was a lush when you pointed him. You're gag writers. Yeah, your gag writers are here, Abe. What do you want them for? You want to come back with something funny the next time they ask, huh? Maybe an anecdote about a town drunk? Abe, anecdotes aren't that easy to come by. I might be able to come up with a squelcher. I can't promise anything. I'll get them working on it, Abe. Right. All right. Abe, you got the speech. You haven't changed the speech, have you, Abe? Abe, what do you change the speech for? You're no writer, kid. A few minor changes. I'll bet. All right, let's hear him. Let's hear him. You what? You typed it. Abe, how many times have we told you? On the backs of envelopes. Well, it looks ad-lib that way, like you wrote it on the train coming down or something like that. You can't read it that way, huh? Abe, we're getting a lot of play in the press on that, kid. Abe, could you do this? Could you memorize it and then put it on the backs of the envelopes? Try it that way, would you? How are the envelopes holding out? You got enough, you're sure. All right. What else? You change 87 to what? To 87. I understand it means the same thing, Abe. Yeah. Abe, that was meant to be a grabber. Well, Abe, it's sort of like saying, Mark Anthony saying, friends, Romans, countrymen, I got something I want to tell you. You see what I mean? Abe, we test marketed that Neary, and they loved it. They flipped for it. Will you trust me on this, Abe? All right, what else? People will little note nor long remember. What could possibly be wrong with that, Abe? They'll remember it. Abe, they'll remember it. But, Abe, it's the old humble bit. You can't say it's a great speech. I think everybody's going to remember it. I mean, you come off a braggart, that's why. Abe, would you do the speech the way Charlie wrote it? Will you do that for me? Anything else? You talk to some newspaper men. Abe, how many times have we told you not to talk to newspaper men? You always put your foot in your mouth, is why. No. No, you were a rail splitter, then an attorney. Abe, it doesn't make any sense the way you wouldn't give up your law practice to become a rail splitter, don't you? Abe, would you read the biography? It's going to save a lot of trouble on this end, kid. Uh-huh. Abe, I don't know. Tell you the truth, I don't know myself. It's Eddie's idea, I'll ask him. Eddie, why'd he split rails? Abe, you split them to build fences. No, fences. Well, I don't know, that's what Eddie says. He used to live there, he ought to know. But Abe, before I forget, listen, the manufacturer is coming out with the Abe Lincoln T-shirt on Tuesday. Well, I think the way they finally settle on, it'll be Abe in black, and the rest of the T-shirt will be white. Could you work that into the address somewhere? It would really hypo sales, Abe, if you... I understand it's a cemetery dedication, Abe. Right off the top of my head, I can't think of any way either. Abe, play it by ear. Whatever you can do, you know, we'll appreciate on this end. Right. Listen, Abe, a bunch of the guys at the agency, we've been kicking around this idea. Just let me lay it on you, sort of off the top of our heads. If you don't like it, it goes out. Listen, Abe. Norm Lincoln. You don't like it. You don't like it, Abe, it goes out. All right. Now, enough. Just want to show you, Abe, although you're not our biggest client, we're still thinking about you. Right. Abe, hold on a minute. Charlie's come up with a thing on Grant. Right. Abe, listen to this. Right. Next time they bug you about Grant's drinking, right, you tell them you're going to find out what brand he drinks and send a case of it to all your other generals. Well, no. See, it's like the brand was the reason he won. No. Abe, use it. It's funny, Abe, use it. Trust us on this, would you? Saturday night. Yes, Saturday night. I should be in Washington. What have you got in mind, Abe? Bridge party at the White House. Abe, what am I thinking about? Abe, I'm sorry, I got to go out with Shirley, and we got to romance a client. Oh, that's a shame, Abe. Yeah, well, Shirley loves to get together with you and, what's her name? Mary. How about Seward? He's busy too, huh? Gee, that's a shame. Abe, listen, why don't you take in a play? I'll talk to you, Abe. Thank you.